of the sun, where to stand in the morning. Who told the ocean you can only come this far? And who showed the moon where to hide till evening? Whose words alone can catch falling stars? Let this life within me cry, I know my Redeemer lives. The very same God who spins things in orbit runs to the weary, the worn and the weak, and the same gentle hands that hold me when I'm broken, they conquer death to bring me victory. No, I know my Redeemer lives. I know my Redeemer lives. Testify, let this life within me cry, I know my Redeemer, he lives to take away my shame, and he
God clap there. Let's do that again. Thank you, Lord, right? All right, you can go home in a minute. Take out your Bibles and turn to Ephesians chapter 1. Ephesians chapter 1. I love Easter. It's by far my favorite day of the year. Of course, we get to celebrate the risen Lord every day of our life. I understand that, but it's nice just to come together as a community and just remember what Jesus has done. What I love about Easter is that it reminds me of the power of God. It reminds me of the power of the risen Lord. And that power that raised Jesus from the dead is power that is available for our lives today. In fact, we're going to see this morning in God's Word, it says that the same power that was exerted to raise Jesus from the dead is the power that lives in us through faith. the same power for our lives. Zachary, our son, and our daughter-in-law were down this week, and he turned 27, but we went to see Aladdin at the Pantages, the musical Aladdin. Oh my goodness, it was just wonderful. And of course, if you know the story of Aladdin, who's got the power? It's the genie, right? The genie has the power, or whoever rubs the lamp, right? And then the genie comes out. Of course, so Aladdin finds this lamp and he rubs it, and the genie comes out and says, "You can have anything that you want. I'll give you 3 wishes. You can't wish for anybody to die. You can't wish, I'm not gonna force anybody to love you." That's interesting, because love is a choice. Just like choosing Jesus, choosing to accept and put our faith in Jesus, God's never gonna force that. So love's a choice. So genie says, "I can't do that, can't kill anybody, and ex-nay on wishing for more wishes," right? You can't do that. That'd be the first thing I'd do. Give me 1,000,000,000,000,000,000 wishes, okay? And then at the end of in this show, by the way, the character that played Aladdin, he stole the show. He was so talented. But in the end, I guess it's the Sultan, and the Sultan wants to be powerful too. And so he steals the lamp and he rubs the lamp and he says, "I want to be the most powerful genie in the universe." And so the wish is granted, but where do genies go? They go into a bottle, right? So boom, into the bottle, and then they lock the bottle away so the genie can't get out. The think about the power and think about energy this morning. The power of God. Now, I don't know about you, but sometimes, some mornings, I wake up and I just don't have any energy at all. Anyone else like that? Like, it takes power to get out of bed, right? Not on Easter. I'm up ready to fly on Easter. But some mornings, you know, the truth is, this world can be draining. This world can be depressing. It can bring you down. The trials and the challenges of this life, they just have a way of just, you know, sucking the energy right out of us. And we need energy. We need power. We need the type of power that God talks about in Ephesians. I went to Google, as if Google would know. Google's all powerful. Google's the all powerful. So, you know, Google knows everything. So I go to Google and I type in, "What's the most powerful thing in the universe?" And to my surprise, it didn't say God. I mean, imagine that. God wasn't even listed there. What is the most powerful thing in the universe? And so I read about something called hypernovas. Maybe you knew that. We have a picture of there's a hypernova, or GRBs. They're called gamma ray burst. So here's what Google says. The most mind-boggling explosion that you can imagine doesn't come close to what the universe can create. When stars 150 times the size of our sun explode, they produce the brightest light sources in the universe, and they release as much energy in a few seconds as our sun will produce over its entire lifetime of 10 billion years. Now get your mind around that. I can't get my mind around that. That 10 billion years of the energy that our sun produces in just a matter of a few seconds, a gamma ray burst has that much energy, that much power. It's about the same amount of energy in a 10 trillion, trillion, billion megaton bomb. These explosions generate beams of high energy radiation called gamma ray bursts, GRBs, which are considered by astronomers to be the most powerful thing in the universe. And I'm here to tell you this morning, they are wrong. That is wrong. The most powerful thing in this universe is the one who created these GRBs, gamma ray bursts. The most powerful one in the universe is Jesus Christ, who created everything. He created the universe, everything that we can understand and can't understand. Beyond it, God is the most powerful thing in the universe. You put all the gamma rays together, He created that. He is the ultimate source of power and the ultimate source of energy. Listen, a gamma ray can't bring light into your darkness. A gamma ray can't heal your marriage. And all the light that a gamma ray brings is nothing compared to the light that stepped down into darkness to heal your soul, to bring you back into a relationship with God. That is powerful. Gamma rays are just a tiny, tiny piece, just a blip of power in the universe that God has created. And the good news this morning is that Jesus Christ is risen from the dead, and the power that raised Jesus from the dead is power through faith that God says is available for your life. Look at Ephesians chapter 1. And, you know, this is a prayer, and I would just pray for you today, if you could just set aside the craziness and the noise in your mind for a moment and get your heart around what God's Word says here. If you understand just a piece of this, it will change your life today. It will change your fears. It will change your sorrows. It will change your darkness. It will change your sin. If you just get a little bit of this and you believe in the power of Jesus Christ, it will transform you. It can transform your outlook on your finances, your outlook on your marriage, your outlook in the workplace. This is transformative. So please, my prayer for you is I pray you can understand what God's Word says here. Ephesians chapter 1, verse 18. I pray that the eyes of your heart may be enlightened in order that you may know the hope to which He has called you, the riches of His glorious inheritance in His holy people, and His incomparably great power for us who believe. Tell me about that power. What's that power like? That power is the same as the mighty strength He exerted when He raised Christ from the dead. And He seated Him at the right hand in heavenly realms, far above all rule and authority, power and dominion. And every name that is invoked, not only in this present age, but also in the one to come. And God placed all things under His feet, and appointed Him to be head over everything for the church, which is His body, the fullness of Him who fills everything in every way. How'd you hear that? Christ wants to fill you. He's got the power to fill you everything in every way that you need to be full, to bring that abundant life that we long for and were created for to us through the eyes of faith. Hey, we turned this stage into a boxing ring for our Easter production last Friday. It was just a great evening to be together. And for those of you who are here, you know that there were ropes up, and some of our younger adults were playing parts, and Kenneth played the part of God, and Zach played the part of Jesus, and Satan just was a little too good by Connor. Connor played the part of Satan. He was way too good. Went home with nightmares when he's, God, he's not getting here. These spirits. I'm like, whoa. We said we have children here. But anyways, you know, here's the thing. It's called, what is it, the champion, right? And I had never seen this. I might have heard, but I'd never seen it kind of played out. And it's Jesus and Satan having this boxing match, okay? So they're acting this out. And then finally, Satan thinks he has the final blow. And he just throws this punch, and it hits Jesus, and it falls to the ground. And then Kenneth's in the back, you know, being the father, and he does a countdown of 10, 9, 8, and Jesus, of course, gets up. And that's a powerful example. I'm not sure how theologically sound all that was, but hey, you know, I'm going to run with it. But the reality, you know, Jesus wasn't just knocked out right? And Kenneth starts to count to 10, 9, 8, and of course Jesus gets up. But you know, it wasn't just a 10 count. I want you to understand Jesus was completely dead for 3 days. He was gone. He was buried. And then by the power, this power that we can't even fathom this morning, Jesus Christ comes back to life. So listen to what God's word says about the power of Jesus Christ. Number one is incomparably great power. Nothing compares. There's nothing you can fathom that has more power than God's power. And this power in Jesus is far above every authority. So there's no authority in heaven and on earth that has more power than Jesus Christ. It's above every power, it's above every dominion, it's above every realm or name. And what does it mean it's above every name? Have you ever invoked a name to try to give more power to a statement? I mean, like, we used to make promises, and like a pinky promise gave it more power, or I promise on my mom's whatever, you know. Well, in the time of Jesus, you know, the Caesars had the power, right? And so if you were to say something, you're like, in the name of Caesar, I tell you to do this, then you better act because it's Caesar's name. Or, you know, they believe the stars had power. And so they would call and invoke a star for certain power, okay? So what God's word is saying, look, there's nothing that compares. Jesus is above every name. Every name. That's why I love praying in the name of Jesus. When we say in Jesus' name, this is what comes to mind. He is the name above all names. And through faith, we can go to God in the name. That's the power of God in us, that the name of Jesus, that every tongue will confess that Jesus is Lord. Every knee will bow, either on heaven or in heaven or on earth. Everyone will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. You can do it in this life, or you can do it in next. But one day, I pray it's now, you realize that Jesus is the one with the power for your soul, for the power for your life. It also says in this present age, and what that's saying in the age to come, what that's saying is right now, you can have that power of God in your life, that you need that power of God in your life. You can call on Jesus. You can trust in Jesus this morning. And that power is in you. So what does that mean? What does that mean? Okay, I've got power for my life. It means everything. The power of Jesus means everything for your life today. When you put your faith in the risen Lord, the power of Christ lives in you and lives through you. And you have access to the power of God, not for your own glory, but for the glory of God. You become God's glory through the power of Jesus Christ. So stop trying to live your life like you have the power. You don't. You don't. You can't control the next 5 minutes. You cannot control tomorrow, which is why Jesus says, don't worry about tomorrow. Today's got enough trouble of its own. You don't have the power to secure your future. You don't have the power to bring health to your body. You could do some things to help, but ultimately, you could wake up tomorrow, as many people did today, and find out you have cancer. I have a good friend that recently had lost his wife. She just a few months ago, she went to bed and she didn't wake up. And then 2 weeks ago, he had a massive heart attack. Just 2 weeks ago, he's in bed this morning, recovering. You don't know. You don't have that power. And you know what gets in the way of us relying on God? I think it's pride, right? You know, I'm going to do this myself. I can work myself out of this problem. I'm just going to pick myself up by my bootstraps and I'm just going to get after it. I'm going to work harder and I'm going to work longer and I'm going to solve this. And you're tired. And you're broken. When I get prideful, I turn to Job chapter 38. And we don't have time to read the entire chapter. Let me read just a little bit for you. This is God's way of saying, who's got the power? This is God's way of humbleness and saying, guess what? You don't have the control over your life that you think you have. Job 38, he's having a conversation with God, and Job got to the point where he was just sick and tired of his life and the way things were going, and I know he had it bad, I get that, and it was really bad for Job, but he gets to that point where he's like, you know, I'm going to ask God, I'm going to tell God a few things. I'm going to speak my mind to the Lord, and I'm going to ask him a few questions. And so Job does that in chapter 37, then you get to chapter 38. And it says this, then the Lord spoke to Job out of a storm. Isn't that interesting? You know, God speaks out of our storms. So Job speaks out of the storm, or God speaks out of the storm. And here's what he says to Job. Who is this? Who is this that obscures my plans with words without knowledge? Brace yourself like a man. I don't ever want God to say that to me, okay? Whoa! It's like take a few steps, fall on the ground, lay prostrate. You know, he says, hey, brace yourself like a man. I got a few questions for you. And you will answer me. Here we go. Where were you when I laid the earth's foundations? Tell me if you understand who marked off its dimensions. Surely you know who stretched out a measuring line across it. And on were its footings, on what were its footings set? Or who laid its cornerstones? While the morning stars sang to each other and all the angels shouted for joy. Who shut up the sea behind doors when it burst forth from the womb? When I made the clouds its garment and wrapped it in thick darkness. When I fixed limits for it and set its doors and bars in place. Have you comprehended the vast expanses of the earth? Tell me if you know all this. Oh, we think we know so much. Oh, we discovered a gamma ray. Oh, that's powerful. God's like, what? Who cuts a channel for the torrents of rain and a path for the thunderstorms to water a land where no one lives? An uninhabited desert. To satisfy a desolate wasteland and to make it sprout with grass. Does the rain have a father? Whose father drops the dew? And I hear that, it's like God's like saying, who's your daddy? You know? It's me you're talking about. This is God the Father. Job 38, the verse you see on the screen here. Can you bind the chains of the Pleiades? Can you loosen Orion's belt? Guess what? God can. The Pleiades are a cluster of seven stars. And again, they believe these stars had power. But it's God who made the stars that has the power. All the power of God comes into our lives when we believe in the risen Christ. God has power over everything in this world, and God has power over everything for your life. So why do you continue to give other things power? Who controls you? Who has power over you? Oh, nobody has power over me, really. Nobody has power over you. How about the power of people's opinions? Do people's opinions have power over your life? What are my friends going to think? What are my friends going to think about me if I dress like this, or I do this, or I wear this? What are my work associates going to think about me? What are people at church, or my family, or people in my neighborhood? See, we are powerless to people's opinions. They rule us when we give them power. We give other people's power for the way that we dress, the way that we think, the way that we talk. The things that we buy? Did advertisers know that? So I looked up the top five income grossing commercials. I actually looked up the top 10, but we'll just have time for five of them this morning. It just shows the power of influence, the power of people's perceptions that gets to us. So Beyonce was number five, okay? She's making bank from Pepsi. 50 Cent for Reebok G's unit sneakers. In other words, they're 50 Cent. Is 50 Cent like a person or a group or what? Sorry. Whoever it is, they are making money because of the power of influence, you see. So if this person endorses this product and I wear this product, then I'm going to feel important. I'm going to feel better about myself right. If I wear, what, 50 cents for Reebok. Okay.
50 cents.
What? All right, next. Number three, LeBron James for Nike. Number two, these are like the highest paid advertisers. Number two, Tiger Woods, still for Nike. Number one, David Beckham. For Adidas. Listen, he was paid $160 million by Adidas to represent tennis shoes. Soccer shoes, I'm sorry, but you know. Hey, I don't care if they're cleats or if they're tennis shoes or if they're shirts. They're all gonna stink in the end. And we're gonna throw them out. That just shows the power of people's perception of us. If I wear these, listen, it's not gonna make you jump higher. It's not gonna make you run faster. It's not gonna make you more important. It's not gonna make you more cool. It's not gonna bring more energy or power into your life. People will do anything to feel good about themselves. And we want people's approval when really we should only seek the approval of one, and that is God, who has all the power. Seeking God's approval. I also want to talk about fear, because fear has power over us today. Fear has power over our finances, fear about our health, fear about our future, fear of catastrophe, fear about politics, fear about death, fear, worry, anxiety. I could just go on and on about the power of fear. Do you know what the most common phrase in the Bible is? Do not be afraid. I thought, oh, well, the most common commandment would be love one another. That's the most important commandment, but it's not the most common commandment. The most common commandment is do not be afraid. Do not fear. And the reason we do not have to be afraid is Jesus Christ has conquered death. He is risen from the dead. Amen?
Amen.
You don't have to fear. You don't have to fear cancer. You don't have to fear a heart attack. You don't have to fear for your children, because they are in God's hands. What is it that keeps you up at night? You don't have to be afraid. The presence of Jesus is more powerful than any fear that we have. 90% of the people in this room, 90% will die of either cancer or a heart attack. One of the two. But you do not have to be afraid. Because the power of the presence of Jesus is the ultimate power source for your life today, in this age, and the age to come. And it has the power to transform you, the power to forgive you, the power to bring the hope and peace that you long for, to bring joy into your heart. Jesus has power over every fear that you have, because he is risen. So what will you do? Or what will you not do? Do not be afraid. Put your trust, put your faith in Jesus Christ, and stop believing in the lies that this world offers. because we believe in the resurrection of Jesus, then we can be confident that everything he said is true. Because Jesus is risen, we know he is the Son of God. He is the Christ. He is the Lord. He is our Savior. He is our forgiver, our Redeemer, our Lord, our Messiah, our hope, our life, our light. He is our King, and he is our friend. He is love, and he has all authority and all power and all dominion for all time. And he has power over death. He is eternal. He is present. He is the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. He is our inheritance. He is holy. He is high priest. He is head of the church. He is giver of living water. He is faithful. He is true. He is just. He is judge. He is the bringer of light and peace to our lives. He is the resurrection. He is the door. He is the gate. He is the way, the truth, and the life. He is the good shepherd. He is peace, joy, hope, and he is the fulfillment of the love of God. So what will you do? How will you respond? This morning, will you trust him? Because look what it says. It says, for those who believe, on this next slide here. One more. He is incomparably great power for who? Us. That's what God's word says. His incomparably great power for us who believe. And it's not to be that genie who can just cause all these things to happen or grant all your wishes. It's not for that. It's for your soul. It's for your life. It's for your hope. So stop trusting in the things of this world that keep bringing you short, and you know what they are. Stop believing in that. And this morning I encourage you, at least begin to examine the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. We believe it to be true. It's so important that Jesus died for your sins, so that you can be forgiven. God in the flesh paying his price on a cross for your sins, for my sins. That he was buried. According to scripture, he was buried. He was in the grave. And 3 days later, by the power of God, he conquered death. And that means you can conquer death as well. You don't have to live in fear. You can lay your head on your pillow at night, and know no matter what happens in politics, no matter what happens in wars, no matter what happens to this nation, no matter what happens from people, no matter if you're driving down the street and a drunk driver hits you, no matter if a terrorist tries to blow up a school or blow up a city or some crazy person tries to blow up America, you rest in peace because Jesus is risen from the dead. Let's pray. God, thank you. We just want to say thank you. And I pray, God, as your word started out this portion of scripture in prayer, that you will open the eyes to our heart. Open the eyes so that we could see from our heart, Lord, that this is real, that this is true, that you are risen. And it makes all the difference for our lives today, for our marriage, for our work, for our family, for our children, for eternity. Thank you, Jesus. We pray in your name. Amen. There is an endless song.